Welcome back to another service at New Calvary Church. What an awesome privilege it is for us to study the Word of God. And every week as we study the Word of God, I trust that God is helping you understand His passion, His desire, His intended purpose for bringing revelation to us so that we would know how to live the righteousness of God. We have been studying the book of Hebrews, and I trust that it has been a study that has helped you understand the redemptive work of Jesus Christ. But I also hope that it has helped you really put your arms around the word faith. And we have been studying and trying to understand what really faith is and how do we understand faith, and have come to realize that if we are going to do anything with the faith that God is putting into our heart, it cannot be static, but it has to be transformational. It doesn't just come out of the fact that I say I believe, but it actually comes out of a relationship of walking with God and trusting the Lord and becoming obedient to Him. And every time we become obedient to Him, we actually demonstrate a deeper and a greater level of faith. And I trust that this has been. Chapter 11 has been a really exciting experience for myself, not only studying it to minister the Word of God, but also to assess and understand how I can go deeper in my walk and my faith with the Lord Jesus Christ. I hope it's been the same, and I trust that today as we end the 11th chapter, that you would really begin to understand and process and think through the significance of the study that we have had on the subject of faith, of things or convictions that we have and hope for, and the assurance that they will happen because of our faith in a sovereign and eternal God. So this morning, I welcome you to New Calvary Church, and I trust that this will be a time of great blessing for you as we minister wherever you are, in whichever part of the world, at whatever time. And I hope that if you're finding this a blessing, that you're sharing it with others and inviting others. And please make sure, if we can send them the link, that we would be glad to if you send us the email address. So now let's begin the service, and will you pray with me as we ask God to minister to our hearts. Father, we want to thank you for the opportunity to come into your presence every Sunday, but realizing, O Lord, that there may be others who listen and watch to this service on another day, maybe in their car, maybe as they're sitting in their office, maybe as they're just relaxing around a table, maybe in their home and in their living room. Wherever they are, I pray, Lord Jesus, because you promised where two or three are gathered in your name, you would minister to them. And I pray, Father, that this message on the last passage in the 11th chapter of Hebrews will continue to become a great blessing to the hearts of those who are listening. And so, Father, we thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to come into your presence. We ask this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Now let's worship the Lord as we sing in praise and adoration to Him.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to New Calvary Church. This morning, I don't know who needs to hear this, but if you're feeling insecure and you're feeling you're left all alone, I have a good news for you. Jeremiah 31:3 says, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and I have continued my faithfulness in you. Church, His everlasting love is loyal, and it is way beyond our imagination. And the good news is, even death cannot separate us from His love. Death has no dominion over those who love Him and those who are loved by God. Remember, you're not out of His sight, and you're always safe and secure in His palm. His love for you will never change according to your sin. And this morning, He wants you to know that you're very special to Him. Having this thought in our mind, let's sing few songs for the glory of God.
just one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up and never runs out on me.
Isaiah 54 verse 10 says, "Though the mountains be shaken and the hills be removed, yet my unfailing love for you will not be shaken, nor my covenant of peace be removed."
Changed, renewed, flowing from the grace that I found.
Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for this precious time that you have given us. Thank you for the opportunity to serve you and to worship you. Lord, help us to always remember the biggest sacrifice that you have done on the cross for us. Thank you for the everlasting love, and help us also to share this love with the people around us. I commit the rest of the time in your mighty hand. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
I trust it's been a great opportunity for us to have been in the presence of God and worshiped Him as we sang these songs of adoration and worship to Him, because He's worthy of our praise. The question that I have this morning is, are you ready to hear the Word of God? It's time to open your Bible and listen to the Word. And I trust as you hear Vijay that you would allow him to minister God's Word this morning to you in your home or wherever you are. Let's hear his Word.
Good morning, church, and welcome back to Hebrews. And today we are at the last few verses of the great Hall of Fame of Faith, which is chapter 11. And today we are going to look at the last 8 verses. And even as the author concludes this particular chapter, we are going to look at some amazing things. But before we go into that, I would like to ask you something. What's your story? Just think about it. You know, God is creating stories with every life. God is creating story with every moment, with every delay, with every disappointment, with everything that we face, our victories, our failures, our joys, our happiness, the up times, the down times, the waiting times. God is busy writing a story. It would be sad if we don't realize it. It would be even more sad if we don't understand it. As we look at today's passage, we are going to look at, we have been looking at, in fact, all this time, we have been looking at amazing stories that God wrote through His people. But today, as we conclude this chapter 11, we are going to look at some amazing stories. We are going to look at how God enables people to live a life of faith. Different ways, different people, different timings, but one thing is in common, that God is writing a story with each one of us. So as we go into this passage, think about this one question: what's your story? The passage for us today is from Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 32 to verse 40. So let me read that for you. Verse 32 onwards. And what more shall I say? I do not have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, about David and Samuel and the prophets, who through faith conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned into strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. There were others who were tortured, refusing to be released, so that they might gain an even better resurrection. Some faced jeers and flogging, even chains and imprisonment. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. They wandered in deserts and mountains, living in caves and in holes and in the ground. These were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. Shall we bow down our heads and close our eyes and look to the Lord in prayer? Our Father, this morning, we want to thank you, Lord, for your word. And Father, we pray that as we wait to listen to your word. Father, we pray that you will speak to us, that you will encourage us, that your word will edify us this morning, O Master. And Father, we pray that, Lord, you will meet us at the point of our need. Lord, as we wait upon you, Father, we know that you are a God who will never disappoint us. Lord, we thank you, Lord, because every time we have waited for you, you have delivered us, O Master. You have come through at the right time. And so, Lord, we pray, even as we listen to your word this morning, that, Lord, you will meet us at the point of our need. Be with us and bless us. In Jesus' name we ask by faith. Amen. After all the big names that the writer talks about in the first 31 verses, he then goes about in verse 32 listing few other names. Not that these are lesser than the others. In fact, some of them have been were able to do even bigger things. But then the context that the writer is bringing for us, talking about the different kinds of faith that these, along with the others, lived through to create some amazing stories. So let's look at some of these names and some of these lives and some of these stories. Just a quick snapshot. Gideon, a frightened man who was called by God to deliver Israel from the hand of the Midianites, with only 300 men. We find this story in Judges chapter 6 to 7, two chapters. Another frightened man, Barak. The Lord called him, this time to deliver Israel from the king of the Canaanites. This is in Judges chapter 4 and 5. Samson, a man who was disobedient and carnal for most of his life, but in his final hours, he grew in faith. And he was able to do the unthinkable. Judges again, chapter 13 to 16. Jephthah, a man who'd run away from his brothers early in life, but was raised up as a leader against the Ammonites. You find that in Judges 11 and 12. And then we come to the big man, David, who sometimes gave into fleshly desires, but overall was a man of great faith, trusting in the Lord to fight a giant in his youth, to leading the kingdom of Israel, by relying on the Lord when all was going wrong. Then we have Samuel, a man who was called by God right when he was a young boy. And he was called to rebuke the priests, the people, and even the king. And you find that in 1 and 2 Samuel. Both those books, you find the amazing ministry of Samuel. And then there are many, many, many other prophets who had similar ministries. Ordinary, regular men whose only way was to endure opposition, humiliation, persecution for their faith in God. But they had faith, and because of that, God used them to do amazing and incredible feats in their life. Each man, each name, a story. So again, let me remind you of the question that we are asking this morning. What's your story? As we look at some of these stories, we are going to look at some amazing things about their faith. So let's quickly dive into this 8 verses and look at what is it. What was their story? Their story was, number one, a story of conquering faith. Their story was a story of compelling faith. Their story was a story of continuing faith. And in the end, the writer talks about their story being a story of completing their faith. So as we dive into these stories, come along with me. Keep your Bible ready. And as we look at these scripture portions, let's look at what God has in store for each one of us. We find in verse 33, the Word of God talks about how some of these people had conquering faith. Through their faith, they were able to conquer kingdoms. They were able to administer justice. And they also gained what was promised. Now, when you actually look into that a little more deeply, as we unpack the layers, right, we find that these were ordinary men, but they had amazing impact because of their faith. They were able to conquer kingdoms. You know, that is a political impact of their faith. One man, One woman was willing to do what God wants them to do, can have an impact on the political stage, administer justice. They were able to impact, have social impact in bringing justice to people. And the word of God says they gained what was promised. You know, through their faith, there was a spiritual impact in their own lives and the lives of those around them. Now, how does it happen? But it happens when we find that God is writing the story and not people. You know, we live in an age, we live in a time when people are trying to write their own stories. You know, there are a lot of people, many of us are going to social media, and then we can write a story, right? We talk about what we are doing today, where we are going today, what we are eating today, right? And then there are others who are trying to, you know, do things because they want to prove to the world. Right? Some of them are trying to change history. Some of them are trying to create history. But one thing is sure, one day we will all be history. But in the midst of all this chaos, there are some people, probably whose names we do not know, but God is at work in their life, and they are the stories that the world will know, read, and think about for ages to come. Not because they are some amazing people, because God is going to use them to do amazing things. Now, what does it take to have conquering faith? Well, to begin with, it needs God's agenda. God uses people who are willing to look beyond themselves. It's not about what we want to do. It's not what about what we can get out of it. It's about what God is at work, and if whether we are able to partner with God. You know, conquering faith requires God's agenda, not man's agenda. Because man's agenda is small, limited, and there is no guarantee that it will be fulfilled. Whereas God's agenda is much larger than what you and I can think about. And the word of God says that what the Lord purposes, He will establish. So the onus is on God and not on people. And therefore there is a guarantee that when God sets the agenda, God will bring it to pass no matter what. So conquering faith requires God's agenda. It also requires God's ability. As we look at these people, we find God used ordinary people to accomplish things beyond their scope because they were willing to obey and serve God by faith. God told them to do some amazing things. Sometimes it did not make sense, but they just obeyed because they had faith in the one who called them. And they were willing to serve no matter what. Some of them didn't really want to be leaders. But when God called them, they said yes. It was not about the position that they would hold, but it's about the service that they would do for God by serving people. So conquering faith requires God's agenda, it requires God's ability, but more important than all of that, it also requires God's anointing. God poured out His Spirit and His power in the weak and failing to use them in mighty ways. You know, as we looked at the stories of all those people, right? Many of them, God called when probably they were not ready for it. God called when they were not capable for it. But God called them. In fact, some of them could be discounted, set apart, saying thrown away, useless. But God said no. Because it was not about what man was going to do. It was all about what God was going to do. So my dear friend, why God cannot use you? Do you feel that God can never use you? Why? Why do you feel like that? Why do you think like that? Another way of looking at the same question is, what will stop God from using you and using me? Maybe we may feel that we are very weak, but we have examples in the Word of God that God uses the weak to shame the powerful. Maybe we think that we are not accomplished or we are not educated or we don't have the expertise. Well, God says, I am going to give you the ability, I am going to give you the anointing to do it, provided you are willing to do what I am asking you to do. The only thing that can probably prevent God from using us is when we choose to disobey God and we lose out on the blessing of being used by God. So that's the story of conquering faith. Next, we look at another story, the story of compelling faith. In verses 34 to 35, right, names are not given, but I'm sure you can quickly put names to that list. These were again amazing people in the midst of difficulties, in the midst of dangerous situations, in the midst of deadly situations. God was writing a story of what faith in God can really do. The Word of God talks about the list starting from saying that they shut the mouth of lions. I'm sure you know who that is. Right? Yes. Daniel. But just imagine, Daniel's faith in God had an impact even on animals. Isn't that amazing? Right? But that was not the only thing. Next we find, quench the fury of the flames. If Daniel was great, his friends were equally great, known by their names of Shadrach, Meshach and Abednego. When they refused to bow down to the image of Nebuchadnezzar, they were put in the fiery furnace. And guess what? Because of their faith, there was an impact on even the laws of nature. Fire, which is supposed to burn up everything, could not do it that day. And God was with them in the fire. We find that these people, in the midst of all the difficulties, they were able to exercise amazing, astonishing faith. And there were others who escaped the sword, edge of the sword. They had impact on people and what people can do. You know, some of them went and routed foreign armies. Impact on better and bigger things. Women, you know. One example we can think about is the Shulamite woman who received her dead son back. Their faith in God even had impact on life and on death. The story of compelling faith, what is it really? It's a story where people have, in the midst of difficult, dangerous and deadly situations, have compelled the natural and the forces around them to turn away, to change. Not because of who they are, but because of the God whom they serve. So as we look at this story, we find that faith in God has amazing effects on people. It transforms them, enabling them to take a stand against all odds. You know, one noticeable attribute among the people of real faith that we often find is boldness. Boldness to stand up, to stand tall, to speak up. In the midst of difficult, dangerous, and deadly circumstances. When disaster hits you, where do you turn to? Or rather, whom do you turn to? It was Rick Warren, I think, who said, "You never know God is all you need until God is all you have." You never know God is all you need until God is all you have. And when we are put in those difficult circumstances, and when we come to the understanding and the realization that it is God alone. Just like the wonderful song we sing, "In Christ Alone." But when we truly understand that, our faith in God compels everything around us to change. Dear child of God, are you at this point wanting to give up? Do you have a feeling that it may not turn out right for you in your life? Are you disappointed about something? Are you experiencing delay in your life? Are you unable to give answers to people? This morning God is asking you to hold on. And in the midst of a difficult situation, in the midst of something that you don't know how it will turn out, God says, hold on. Faith in God requires us to carry on in hope of what God can do. Continue in spite of all the odds and compel everything and everyone around us to turn and obey God. God is at work in our life, not just for our sake. Many times God is in work in our life so that He can show His glory for the people around us. And if we don't carry on, if we don't do what God wants us to do, if our faith is not compelling enough, then we may miss out the blessings. And it was Paul who said, the love of God compels me. As we put our faith in God, as we check about our faith in God, here's a question. How much do we really love God? How far are you willing to go because of that love for God? How much are you willing to wait for God to do what He has promised in your life? That's the story of compelling faith. Thirdly, we look at another wonderful story, the story of continuing faith. We look at verses 35, the second part to verses 38. Again, not many names are given. In fact, no names are given, but probably we can put names to some of these people. There were some, because of their faith, they were tortured. And when they were tortured, they had a way out, but they refused to be released. And they faced jeering, flogging, even chains and imprisonment. Now they experienced physical pain, but they continued not wanting to give up. They continued in faith. But for some of them, the end came pretty soon. They were put to death by stoning. Some of them were cut into two. Some of them were killed by the sword. So they not only experienced physical pain, some of them even experienced physical death. But they did not give up. They continued in their faith. And there are many others who experienced physical separation, social separation, from everybody else. They were mistreated, persecuted. They felt like a destitute. They were living in sheepskins, goatskins, not with everybody else, wandering in the desert, in the mountains, living in caves, in the holes, in the ground. I mean, can you think about that? Why would somebody do that, Doesn't it make more sense to give up? But then we have the legacy of people like these who continued in their faith because they were looking at a better resurrection. It was not about life or death. It was about whom they believed. It was about the God whom they served. It was about their conviction in the God whom they believed. So as we look at the story of continuing faith, we find that the Bible never tries to hide the fact that life is full of suffering and pain. Now, there are tears and turmoils, difficulties, obstacles, sicknesses, death, especially for people who are in the faith. Well, it's unfortunate that nowadays there is another gospel that is being preached, and a gospel that is very convenient, a gospel that is very convincing, a gospel that calls people to become a person of faith so that you can avoid all of life's difficulties. That is not the biblical gospel. That is not what God is calling us for. Now, God, in His Word of God, says that there will be suffering. You know, in John chapter 16, verse 33, Jesus said, "In the world, you will have tribulation, especially if you believe in Jesus Christ." 2 Timothy 3:12, Paul writing, he says, "And indeed, all who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." Now, I don't know why somebody would stop talking about what Jesus said, stop talking about what Paul said, stop talking about what the Bible says, and come up with a story or a false story that when you believe in Jesus, everything will be all right. That is not the gospel. There are people and there are preachers who talk about this. And let me tell you, it has great results because a lot of people are ready to follow. People are ready to follow a gospel that promises them happiness, that promises them prosperity, that promises them riches in life, that promises them an amazing life of material things. Jesus has called us to carry our cross and follow Him. Jesus says that the Son of Man has no place to lay down His head. It's not an easy thing, but it is something that is worth it. So if somebody is saying that the man of faith will never be sick, only healthy, that's not a biblical statement. That's not what the Bible talks about. If somebody says a woman of faith will never be poor, only rich, it's not a given. It is God who gives us, it's God who takes away, because it is God who's writing the story. And what's important for us to understand is God is writing His story. Some people say the person of faith will experience only blessings, no problems. That's not true. There are blessings in the midst of problems. And that's what the story of continuing faith really is trying to help us understand. You know, many people of faith have been persecuted with choices. Forsake your God and we will release you. Worship our false God and you will be given a position of prominence. But they rejected that for a purpose. They rejected that for a reason. If there were no life beyond this one, they would be foolish not to jump at an opportunity like this. You know, give up and enjoy the rest of your life. But they refused. And the reason they refused was because they wanted to make sure that their eternity with their Creator was better than the life that they were living here. Paul reminds us that we should live like strangers in this world, because this is not permanent. But we must live so that one day we will live permanently, eternally with God. So my dear friend, this morning, here's another question. Are you running away from difficulties, taking the easy way out? Are you at the verge of giving up because you can't wait any longer? You're not only ripping yourself of eternal blessings, but also leaving behind a legacy of failed faith, faltering faith. Do you want to have that story attached to your name? God is calling us to a story of continuing faith. A story where we will be talked about. Even after we are gone. From generation to generation. Our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren will be proud that we stuck on a little longer. That we held fast a little longer. That we didn't give up when it really called for faith. The story of continuing faith. In the midst of all odds, we continue because of who God is. And finally, we come to the story of completing faith. Verse 39 and 40. You know, the word of God says they were commended for their faith. Yet, none of them received what had been promised. Meaning to say, what God had promised them as part of God's big agenda. And what was that? That God would send the Messiah. That God would be their king. That God would create his kingdom on earth. But the word of God also says that God had planned something better for us. So that only together with us, they would be made perfect. That their story would be a story of completing faith. The author is not saying that those who did not receive what was promised somehow missed out on God's blessing. No. They went through terrible things in their life. But in the midst of that, they had the blessing of God. Just because some of them died while they were being tortured, some lost their kingdoms, some didn't see fulfillment of prophecies while they were alive, doesn't mean they failed. Doesn't mean that God was not faithful to them. In fact, it's just the opposite. God was faithful even when they were not available. So the story of completing faith is that God's kingdom, God's rule, and God's will is something that they all hoped for, something that they all wanted to see established, but it didn't happen in their lifetime. But they made it possible for others to be ready, for the generations to come, to know that there were people who walked before them. And they are now waiting to complete their faith through the generations to come. We are called to complete their faith. As you look at this whole chapter, chapter 11, are you not glad for how these great men and women of faith lived their lives? Because they have for us, for each one of us, they have kept a model that we can look up to. And they are telling us that it's possible. They are telling us that they have been there and they have done it. They are telling us that they have created a legacy for us to be proud of. But what also chapter 11 is telling us is that it is not the exception, but this is the rule. For a Christian, living in faith is not an exception. That is the rule. When we pray, "Thy kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven," we are talking about a rule that we will all live by. And that rule is to be faithful to God. No matter what. It's not an exception. It's not one out of the many. It is the many that we are talking about. And as we live our lives in faith, they are completing their faith. And they are completing their stories. all that they have done for God, it is still bearing fruit. And they are still getting the blessing of being a blessing to others. Our lives are better because of their legacy. And in a way, we are all in it together. Because the God whom they worshipped is the same God that you and I worship. So as we look at these four stories, story of, you know, conquering faith, compelling faith, continuing faith, and completing faith. So what was their story really? Well, in a nutshell, if we have to understand their story, there are just four things that we need to look at. Number one, it's not about us. Number two, it's not about what we can do. Number three, it's not about what we will get. And number four, it's all about what we are becoming. So what's your story? How do you want your story to be written? Well, we cannot choose because it is God who is writing the story. But God can choose a conquering faith to be your story. God can choose one of compelling faith to be your story. God can choose you to be a part of that continuing faith story. Or God can choose you for the completing faith story. It's not about us. It's all about God. But the question is, God is writing a story with you and a story with me. Am I aware of it? Am I willing for it? Am I in sync with God about the story that He's writing? God wants to write wonderful stories for each one of us. Let's not miss out the blessing that one day our story will be shared, will be told to somebody else. That one day our story of faith will encourage someone else to walk in the ways of the Lord. And until that day, let's be faithful to the God who has called us by living a life of faith. Amen.
Come on. to show to the nations who the path of sorrow hath trod, that all of the world's great peoples may come to the truth of God, may come to the truth of God. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love and light. For the darkness shall turn to dawning, the dawning to noonday bright, and Christ's great kingdom shall come on earth, the kingdom of love.
Father Lord, we want to thank you, Lord, for these great men and women and the wonderful faith that they all had, O Master. And Lord, when we read about them, when we think about them, when we study about them, Lord, many times, Lord, we feel very small. But Lord, this morning we want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for these amazing stories of faith that you have put together so that we can know that it's not the exception, but it is the rule. And Lord, we this morning want to commit ourselves into your mighty hands. Lord, we want to live by faith. We want to live that amazing life like what they have had. And Lord, we know that you have a plan for each one of us. You have an agenda for each one of us. You have a story for each one of us, Lord. Father, we pray that none of us will miss out on the blessing of being a part of your story. And so, Lord, we pray that you will encourage us. We pray, Lord, that you will edify us. We pray, O Lord, that you will push us, Lord, to do what it takes so that we can live by faith. We thank you, Lord, for your word. Help us, O Lord, to receive it and live by it. In Jesus' precious name we ask by faith. Amen. And now unto him who is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless before the throne of grace, may the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us and help us to walk with God even as he is writing his story in our lives. Now until the coming of our Lord. And all of God's people said, Amen. Thank you, church. Thank you for being a part of this service. Have a wonderful life. Have a wonderful week. And keep trusting God. And keep walking in faith. And keep looking to God for the wonderful story that He's writing with you. God bless you.